our scripture reading and our shepherd's prayer. So let's all sing King of My Heart.
Let the King of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he is my song. Let the King of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he is my song. You are good, good. You are good,
Good morning. Our reading this morning will be Psalms 34, verses 1 through 8. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes it boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from my fears. Those who look at him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. O taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him.
Good morning. Let us pray. Our Father, your kingdom come, your will be done on this earth. Father, we come before you acknowledging how small we are and how great you are. Greater than this world, greater than this universe, greater than time itself. You are the creator of all, the sustainer of all. Without you, there is no love. Without you, there is nothing. We acknowledge that. Father, we come knowing that in spite of the difference between us and you, that you still listen to us, you still want, desire, and answer each and every one of our prayers. And Father, today we come praying for this congregation. There are several people in this congregation who are grieving for the loss of loved ones. We pray for their grief. We pray that in time that you will turn these sad days into days of remembrance of the good things, of the times, and of the hope that we have to see them again. Father, we also have many people in this congregation who are hurting, who have arthritis, who have cancer, who have heartache. We pray especially for Mary Cowan, who has fallen and broken her hip. We pray that you would help those who are working with her to bring her back to health. We pray for John Sargi as he is to undergo a very complicated knee surgery this week. We pray that it would be successful and that he would return here quickly. We pray for others that I'm not aware of, but I know that you are aware of. And Father, I also want to spend this time this morning in prayer, praying for your kingdom. I pray that it would truly, completely come on earth to fill the earth. And Father, as I look out in the world, I look at my own skills, my own talents, and say, what can I do? And Father, I'm sure that's the way many in this congregation feel when we look at what each of us can do. But Father, I know that if we pull in unison, if we pull together, that one can be joined by 10, by 100, by a million, and by millions. And the pull that that can exert on the world is immeasurable, especially if you are pulling with us. So, Father, I pray that throughout the remainder of today, this week, and the rest of my life, that you would show me how to pull, how to join your team, be on your side, and pull to bring others to Jesus, to bring those who once knew Jesus and have lost their way back to the path, and to have your kingdom on this earth truly come and truly be the light of the world. It's in all these things that I pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
We are going to move into our time of communion now. I'm thankful that we get to do this together every week. If you haven't grabbed your communion, it's available in the buckets in the back. We're going to sing Living Hope, and then Carrie McDonald will come up and lead us in that time together.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could.
Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Good morning. Isn't that a beautiful song? James 4:8 says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. That's another beautiful promise we have. And this Lord's Supper that we're about to take is one of those opportunities we have to draw closer to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your love and your greatest gift of the sacrifice of your Son. And we're so thankful for that sacrifice of love and the victory on the cross. Help us to examine ourselves as we take this communion and make sure that we're doing everything we can to live our life for you. And as we eat this bread, let's think back to Jesus' body that he gave willingly on the cross for us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's go to God in prayer again. Dear Father, as we drink this fruit of the vine, we're so thankful that Jesus was able to live a perfect life for us and keep his blood pure and to be that perfect sacrifice that we know that the blood of animals was not sufficient, but we needed a perfect sacrifice in Jesus. And help us again, try to do our best to live our life for you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now is our time to pray for the offerings and just be thankful for the many blessings that we've been given. And on the screen, you'll see multiple different ways that we can give to the work here at College Side. Let's pray for those offerings. Dear Father, we thank you so much for blessing us way more than we deserve. And help us to remember that we are so blessed, and help us to remember to give back of our time and of our money and any way that we're able to further your kingdom, and help us as a church to use those gifts in a way that that would honor you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Rey Jesús en toda majestad.
We're thankful for all the opportunities that we have to support our missions here at College Side, and one of those missions that we support in many different ways is MANA Global Missions. And I don't know if I've said this publicly, but MANA and Flint had a race a few weeks ago, a 5K, and over 50 of you here ran that race. And all that went to support their mission in Flint. So thank you so much for that. There's so many awesome ways to connect here right now at College Side. And you all are supporting those things in mighty ways. Whether it's how many have come to the men's breakfast, which was over 60 came last month. And the next one will be this Saturday at 7 a.m. in Teenside. Over 80 ladies went to the ladies' retreat. 60 or 80 came to the senior side meal that they had. There's so many things happening and opportunities for you to connect. I hope you will look for those opportunities. The church directories, or as I like to call them, the 2022 College Side yearbooks, are now available in the back. They are here today. Thank you to the ladies in the office who put them in individual bags so you can just walk up, find your name, and take your church directory. So I hope that you'll grab those, as well as the Magi boxes, which that's why we just watched that video. Those boxes that they are holding in that video are the boxes that you all put together here for them for Christmas time. So those boxes are in the back, and we will fill a lot of them. So I hope you'll grab one of those today. And also, just a reminder, we are on the back half of the year. I know a lot of you got messages from me this week to do bios and devotionals. Every Monday, our College Side Family Devotional comes out. I hope you check that out. You can find it on your app. You'll get emails for that. But we'll have a new one tomorrow. Let's go to the next slide. College Side Softball. We've talked about this a couple weeks. Sunday, September 24th, it will be at Jerry Whitson Softball Fields. And we are looking to put together four teams to play. That includes the guys that already play, but men and women can sign up if you want to play softball. There's the QR code. Go now. We'll put that up. Matthew, let's put that up right at the end of service, okay? So that you can scan that QR code and sign up to play softball with us. But the big thing we need you to know tonight is one of our traditions to welcome back our Tech students, which are all right here, Tech students here. Yeah, yeah. Is we have our annual ice cream social. So the whole back half of this room will have tables tonight and will be covered with homemade ice cream. We will have a homemade ice cream competition and a singing together, and we will see who will win the golden scoop tonight. So you can still sign up to bring ice cream on the back walls. Do that as you're grabbing your directory and grabbing your Magi boxes. So that's all the announcements I got right now. So let's all stand together. We're going to dismiss our children to children's worship, and then John will bring us the next lesson in the blessing series. We're going to take a trip back in time to youth group times, and then in honor of our kids at McBroom Chapel, we're going to do an old Songs of the Church, Count Your Blessings. We'll do that before John's lesson. So let's sing together.
Hosanna, you're my King. I worship and I sing.
I worship and I sing.
I lift your holy name.
Upon high.
I worship and adore. Seek praise forevermore.
take just a minute and greet those around you. We'll start after that. Good morning. It's always a blessing to be together. Thank you so much for taking just a minute and greeting those around you. If you're a guest with us today, man, we hope that you feel welcome. We hope that you feel loved. We're thankful that you're here, and we would invite you to be back with us at any opportunity you have. Let me say one thing just by way of reminder. This Saturday, there will be our second men's breakfast at 7 o'clock in Teenside. Last time we were together, we formed some groups to come up with some ideas for how to minister to the men of our church. And I'm excited to hear what people have come up with and where the Lord is leading us. And so if you didn't come last time, would love for you to come. I know it's Labor Day weekend, and so there will be a lot of people that will be gone and traveling, but we've committed ourselves to meeting every first Saturday of every month from here on out, and there will be other things that you'll hear about this Saturday. So make plans to be here if you haven't already. Before we start, let's pause, let's pray, let's ask God to help us as we study His Word together, and then we'll begin. Let's pray. God, our Father, we're thankful for every opportunity we have to study Your Word, and we thank You every Sunday. Father, we mean that, and I pray for us that You would help us not treat this moment as a road experience, but as something that it's transformative and an opportunity every week. Amen. Father, I pray that You would speak to us through Your Word. We're confident that You will. Father, I pray that You would give us hearts to hear what You say to us this morning, that Your voice above all others is the voice that we key in on and zero in on. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, and we all said, Amen. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Aaron and his sons, saying, thus you shall bless the people of Israel. You shall say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. So shall they put My name upon the people of Israel, and I will bless them. We noticed a couple of things about that first phrase last week. There's a difference between the blessing of the Lord and all the blessings of the Lord. The blessings of the Lord flow out of the blessing of the Lord, but I want you to know you have the blessing of God, or you don't. The blessing of the Lord is the foundation for all the blessings of the Lord, and that blessing is above comparison, and it's above happiness. Where we seek and find blessing is where we worship. We noticed that last week. The place that you look for blessing, places that you find blessing, that's where you worship. And it's a roadmap to an altar in your life. Where you feel blessed is a good indication of where you worship. And the third thing is this: the blessing of God is wearing His name. That's what it is. Moses told Aaron to put the blessing of God on the people. The blessing of the Lord comes when you wear the name of the Lord. And that's why it affects your children. It affects their children. It affects everybody around you. It touches everybody around you because you wear His name. I want you to see that up high most of all this morning. When I wear the name of God, it's on me. It's on me. On my body. Everywhere I go, the name of God is on me. And when I wear His name, I have favor. That doesn't mean I win the lottery. It doesn't mean that everything works out the way that I want it to. But I do have favor because I wear the name that is blessed above all other names on this planet. Don't look to Baal. Don't look to respect. Look to God to be your blessing. Your kids, your job, your self-esteem, what satisfies you the most are not blessings the way the blessing of the God is. Be favored by wearing His name and letting His name affect you and affect other people. You know why? The Lord keep you. What's the oldest thing you own? I want you to think about the things that are in your possession. What's the oldest thing that you have? What do you treasure most of all? Out of everything you've got, where you live, or some other place, what do you treasure more than anything else that you own? Now, I would venture to say that a lot of those things did not start with us, did they? They were given to us by somebody else. I think I've told you before that one of the primary reasons I do what I do is because of the church that I grew up in. It wasn't and it isn't a perfect church, but one thing that they did really, really well was encourage all of their young people to participate actively in some kind of ministry. They did it really well, and they still do it well. The preacher at that church, or that was at that church when I was growing up, is still a mentor for me, an example for how I look into the Word and dig for things and try to bring up points every week. I had started preaching when I was about 14 or 15. I gravitated toward that really quickly. So I had preached at my home church. I started preaching at other places around the Nashville area. One Sunday, there was this lady that approached me after the assembly, and she told me, "I want you to come to my house this afternoon, and I want you to bring some boxes." Her name was Lady Frank Sanders. I want you to think about that name, Lady Frank. You don't tell somebody who has that name no. What kind of man's man do you have to be to name your daughter Lady Frank? I went to her house that afternoon with four or five boxes and realized really quickly that I didn't have enough boxes. Lady Frank's dad was a preacher. He was a preacher at the Una Church of Christ in Nashville for years. Her father, Joe, had passed several years earlier, and she had inherited his entire library. She told me when I showed up at that time, first word she said, "It's yours." And I said, what's mine? She said, everything. I was blown away in the moment, but was probably still too young to fully appreciate what she was giving me. And as I've gotten older, I've appreciated that more. And she's passed on and gone to be with the Lord. A library is a big deal for a preacher, even in this day and age, particularly preachers that are driven by text. Don't listen to people who don't read books. They're really important. Within that library, there were three that caught my eye this week. I was thinking about old things in terms of age and value. Within what she gave me that day, almost 20 years ago, right at 20 years ago, was David Lipscomb's commentary on the book of Revelation, which was printed in 1937. An original of Hardiman's Tabernacle Sermons that was published in 1923, and Questions and Answers on the Bible by F.L. Rowe and John Klingman from 1916 stood out to me. They're on my shelf in my office. I also have a lot of Bibles. People give me Bibles. Grandparents, great-grandparents who've gone on to meet the Lord. My dad gave me a Bible called the Scott Family Bible that has the date in the front of it, 1817. It looks like a prop from Indiana Jones. It's incredible. Why do we keep those kind of things? Why do we keep them? Let me ask you a better question. How do we keep them? People keep a lot of stuff. You go to an antique store or a yard sale and you find things that people kept that they wish they did. And I'm talking about the things that you mean to keep. Why do you keep them? Why do we keep stuff that we mean to pass down? The things that you keep reveal what you love. It's the overarching point for today. What you keep is a roadmap for love in your heart. What you treasure is a roadmap for love in your heart. And you keep it because it has value. Maybe not monetary value, but value to you. What you have from your parents, what you have from your great-grandparents, maybe it's a firearm, maybe it's a book, maybe it, whatever it is, you value those things because you love them. How many of you have a piece of furniture that you wouldn't otherwise have, but you've got it because it came from your mom or your grandma? You value that because you love that. What you treasure reveals what you love. A significant portion of this blessing, the Lord's blessing, is the Lord's keeping. He keeps things. Did you know that? He keeps you. The Lord keep you. If you're a child of God, I want you to know this morning, you are being kept by God. You are the thing that He pulls off the shelf and tells stories about. You are the thing that He pulls off the shelf and treasures. If you're a child of God, regardless of how old or young, successful or unsuccessful, useful or how unhelpful you feel, you are kept by God. That word that we translate keep in verse 24 of number 6 is used throughout the Old Testament. It's used 468 times. And 283 of those times, it's translated keep. Keep the law. They kept the commandments. She kept the testimony. When you keep something, you follow it. You heed it. You keep it. You treasure it. When you keep the speed limit, you're keeping it when you follow it. Genesis 17 says, "And God said to Abraham, as for you, you shall keep my covenant." It's the same word. You and your offspring after you throughout their generations. The Lord keep you. He keeps you the same way. That word's also translated protect, defend, guard. It's the idea of being preserved or being saved. David said this in 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 23, "You shall not do so, my brothers, with what the Lord has given us. He has preserved us. He has kept us and given into our hand the band that came against us." David's saying, we've been in danger. We've been running. We've faced enemies, but God is keeping us. He will protect us. He will guard us. He will deliver us. The Lord keep you. And He keeps you in that way. What happens when we don't feel like we're being kept? If you're a child of God, you're being kept. And sometimes the way we feel gets in the way of God, what God wants us to know. There's all sorts of times we don't feel protected, but I want you to know just above our sight, beyond what we can see, in this very moment, if you're a follower of Jesus, you are being kept by God. Or you aren't. If you aren't. Maybe one of the reasons we don't always feel kept by God is our emphasis on what we provide spiritually, but I think that's too easy. I think one of the reasons why there are moments and even long periods of time when we don't feel protected, when we don't feel kept, when we don't feel defended, when we don't feel supported, is because we choose one definition or another. Our vocabulary, the way that we use language, doesn't always function like the original did. When Moses tells Aaron to tell the priest, to tell the people, "The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you," that word "keep" means a little bit of everything. The Lord keeps you the same way He asked them to keep the law. The Lord keeps you the way He kept David from the Amalekites. The Lord keeps you the same way the Psalms over and over and over ask God to keep them by being a refuge for their lives and their souls. So when we want to be kept, or when we want to feel like God is keeping us, we focus on one of those definitions. I don't feel protected because I face some kind of danger. Regardless of your circumstance, regardless of what's right in front of you or what's right behind you, you're being kept. The keeping of the Lord doesn't just show up when I'm in a jam. The keeping of the Lord is always, it's a constant. We've always had a lot of family, so we haven't used the traditional babysitter model often. Casey and I were talking about this week, I think we've used a paid babysitter under 5 times in all of the lifespan of our kids. You know what's interesting about that? My boys talk about those times like they're the best times of their lives. I grew up going to Opryland. Anybody remember Opryland? The way I talk about Opryland is the way they talk about Shayla Huddleston. They love it. They can tell you everything about what they did when she came to babysit them. When I ask someone to keep my kids, what am I asking them to do? I'm asking them to protect them. But is that all I'm asking them to do? I'm asking them to restrain them. Don't put your hand in the oven. But is that all I'm asking them to do? I'm asking them to preserve their life. Don't let somebody in. But is that all I'm asking them to do? When someone keeps your kids, you're asking them to do all of that. You're asking them to be in charge of them. Protection's a part of that. Restraint's a part of that. Preservation's a part of that. When the Lord keeps you, it's more than protecting you. When the Lord keeps you, it's more than preserving you. When the Lord keeps you, He's in charge of you. We're protected by law enforcement. But they're not in charge of us in that way. Doctors preserve us. But they aren't in charge of us in that way. Laws restrain us, but they're not in charge of us that way. God's way more than any of that. He's way more than any of that. One of the fundamental questions we've got to ask as disciples of Jesus Christ is, do we let the Lord be in charge of us? Do we let the Lord engage with us? When the Lord keeps us, He is engaged with us. When we have somebody keep our kids, we want them to protect them, but we also want them to engage them, to spend time with them, to talk to them. Is the Lord in charge of you? When Moses tells Aaron to bless the people, he's thinking differently. He's thinking deeper than the way we would call 911. When you call 911, when there's an emergency, here's my address, here's what I need, here's where I want you to come, and we're kept, but only in that moment. God's way more than that. The blessing of the Lord is way more than that. There is protection, but there's also leadership, there's purpose, there's value when the Lord's in charge. Just like the blessing, we are kept by who we worship. Who you worship. What do you worship? If there are high places in life where you don't feel secure, then I think you're trying to be kept by something other than God. When we worship the things of the world, we're trying to be kept, we're trying to be led, we're trying to be guarded by the same things. Respect isn't going to keep us. Money isn't going to keep us. Health isn't going to keep us. That promotion, that job, whatever that is for you, if you have that, it's not going to keep you. Not the way the Lord does. I'm going to tell you two things as we close our time together this morning. When the Lord keeps you, you are protected. The biblical word keep is translated that way over and over and over again for a reason. Paul said this in the New Testament, 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, the Lord's faithful. He will establish you. He will guard you against the evil one. When the Lord keeps you, He guards you. Moses told the people in Deuteronomy 31, be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be in dread. For the Lord your God goes before you. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. He keeps you. Moses is about to leave. People know it. They sense something's going on. Moses says, don't be afraid. God's going before you. He ain't going anywhere. He's not going to abandon you. He's not going to forsake you. When facing something that feels tough or challenging, when you're up against a challenge, a spiritual challenge that produces growth but also might produce temptation, or when you're faced with something that holds you down, you're protected because you're being kept. The Lord's walking in front of you. Do you have a challenge ahead? Is there something on the horizon that's causing you some stress? Is there a challenge you know you're going to have to face at work, in a relationship, at home, with yourself? You got a practical project that's going to require some bandwidth that you don't know that you have? Or a task that's going to require some energy that you don't know you have. Maybe you got to have a conversation. I want you to know the Lord is walking in front of you and behind you and beside of you. When the Lord keeps you, you're protected. That doesn't mean ease. It doesn't mean comfort. But it means God's presence in everything. When the Lord keeps you, you're protected. When the Lord keeps you, you have purpose. Those books on my shelf have purpose. Their purpose is still attached to their intended original purpose. I can still read those books. I can read thoughts from 100 years ago. That's pretty extraordinary. But as they've aged, as they've been protected by multiple people, their purpose is only deepened. I look at those books on my shelf not just as a mere source of information, but as a representation of being connected to something bigger than me, bigger than us. And that's the purpose of the Lord's keeping. He doesn't just keep you for yourself. He keeps you for something greater, something bigger, to draw other people to himself. I'm a member of a family that's been reading the Word since the 1800s. How extraordinary is that? Some of you are members of a family that's been reading the Word that long. We are members of a church family that's been reading and studying and writing about the Word of God for hundreds of years. The Lord is with you. The Lord keep you. When the Lord is with you, there is value. There's purpose. And it's not monetary. There are a lot of people who come to faith. They come to a relationship with Jesus and they wonder and they think and they pray and they ask for greater purpose. Some feel guilty because they don't feel like they work hard enough. Others feel guilty because they don't think they know enough. Still others feel guilty because they don't think they bring anything to the table with the Lord. I don't want to minimize our contributions, but our purpose is not based on what you do. Your value isn't based on what you provide or what you bring to the table. Your value is based on the blood of Jesus Christ. And every person is of infinite value when they're covered in His blood. God isn't going to forsake you. When the Lord keeps you, there is purpose. There's value. I want you to see yourself as protected. And I want you to see yourself as valuable. Because I believe when you do, when you see yourself that way, it changes everybody around you. And the blessing becomes generational. It's the people of Jesus who tell their kids, you're protected and you're valuable in a way that nobody else can. It's the family of Jesus who knows that they are protected and they are valuable in a way that no one else on planet Earth can. And when we live that way, everything changes. The blessing of the Lord is seen most vividly in your life when you let the Lord be in charge of you. I want to leave you with that question. Is the Lord in charge of you? Have you opened that door? Would you stand with me this morning as we receive the blessing of the Lord? Before your Father, and as a member of this church family, or as a part of an assembly of the Lord's people, even if you aren't a follower of Jesus, what do you need this morning? For those moments when you fear, the Lord keep you. For those moments when you look back and you see God's hand, the Lord keep you. For those moments when you look back and it's hard to see, the Lord keep you. For those times when words fail, the Lord keep you. When that memory comes back and it taunts you, the Lord keep you. For that opportunity in front of you to be a missionary or a testimony of God Almighty, the Lord keep you. For that time when you're called and you don't feel equipped, the Lord keep you. For that time when you know you're in a providential moment, but you don't know the next step, the Lord keep you. Let the Lord be your blessing. Let the Lord keep you. If you don't know Jesus, the Lord is the only one who keeps. And if you don't know Jesus, His invitation is wide open to do that for you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. There is blessing in the name of Jesus. Amen. To wear it, you have to come to know him. If you don't, I want you to know the elders of our church are around this room. They would love to pray with you and for you. They would love to study with you. If you don't know what it means to be a follower of Jesus, that can be taken care of right now. If you are a follower of Jesus, how do you need to be kept? Tell the Lord that, or tell one of the shepherds that. Let's all worship together.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you all for being here again today. If you're a visitor, I hope you felt welcome. We have a starting point back here on the left. As you go toward the back there, Mike and Peggy Polk are there waiting. They'll be there to answer any questions you might have about College Side. Thank you again for being here. This week, I hope that each day we can remember that we are in God's keeping. And what that means to us relative to what was said today here from John. I appreciate his words. I appreciate this lesson today. And I hope that you will be kept this week and know that. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we're thankful for your blessing that you've given us, for keeping us. I pray, Father, that we can have eyes to see and be able to remember the times that you've kept us in our past.
the way that you're keeping us here in our present. And Father, as we look toward the future, the ways that you will keep us, I pray that we can have peace and that we will rest in that keeping. Father, we love you. Pray you go with us through the rest of this day and the rest of our lives, and that we'll look on you for everything. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.